This is a public service announcement brought to you by Kardell Sims and the good folks at TMG Records. Check the forecast. I rain fact, that's true precipitation. Give them time back or use it to build patience. Either or, try to maneuver above basics. So when you touch down, you hover over complacent. Long story short, we made the time count. Incarceration couldn't keep our minds timed out. We just gave clout to the count times and grinded. Made our re-entry a journey out of confinement.
What would be one word to describe this journey?
Enriching.
Unapologeticness.
Elevating.
Resilience. I say transformation.
The re-entry journey. The re-entry journey. The re-entry journey. The re-entry journey. All right. We back. That's right. With another episode of The Re-entry Journey. I am your host, Kardell Sims. And tonight, we got a special guest. We talking about going from prison to the presidential candidate. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a different ball game now. It's crazy. We talking about the hood politics, the hood candidate, a journey from stability a little bit in the beginning, and you know, got a little freedom and chose to hang around just the neighborhood, the gangs, and going through many different trials of life to end up as a presidential candidate coming from prison and the life is an amazing story and amazing journey. So tonight, my guest on the reentry journey, let's welcome to the floor. Let's welcome to the reentry journey to share his story, Mr. Andy Williams. Welcome to the reentry journey.
What's up, Brother Sims, man? Glad to be here, bro.
Oh, man, good to have you. So let us know, give us your story. Let us know about you.
So I grew up in Aurora, Illinois. It's like the second largest city in the state of Illinois, a western suburb of Chicago. My father and mother separated when I was 2. My dad started dating a German lady, aka a white lady, but she's German. She's German. It's my stepmom. They got married, had 2 children, 2 younger brothers. They separated when I was 12. And when they separated, I had always been inspired by looking at the older kids, you know, brothers being in, you know, street organization. It wasn't like it was a negative aspect. It just was something that, hey, they look cool. You know, here it is. I'm growing up in a biracial family and I'm looking at these Hispanic brothers, because I went to the school I went to, grade school, was predominantly Hispanics.
Okay.
And it just looked at, you know, like cool. So, I mean, real talk, I was a straight AB student. Played the saxophone, violin, went on camping trips, I mean, vacations in the summer, went to Germany when I was 7, you know, so I ain't saying I grew up in no, you know, financially deprived household. I didn't. My stepmother, you know, was a disciplinarian, the authoritative figure in the house. And, you know, being a little, you know, colored kids at school teaching, at least my mama ain't white. You know, that kind of...
Oh, no. Right. Oh, no.
Like, neither is my mama. But, you know, so that kind of like shaped some foundational aspects for me. But when they separated, I was in middle school. And middle school is where, you know, the Black Brothers of the Street organizations was. So even though I lived in a Hispanic neighborhood, based on my geographical location, I didn't go to this one middle school. I went to the other middle school. And all the brothers over there was folks. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I naturally gravitated towards that. And I think from the way that I grew up, my foundation, it was easier for me to maneuver through life, because I didn't grow up maybe in some of the circumstances some of them did. Because some of the brothers, you know, in our town had 2-parent households, but they was working, you know, different shifts, you know, different stuff like that. So, you know, it was just a different environment.
Right.
And so that was on the east side of Aurora. And then I flunked out of 9th grade high school. I flunked. And when I went back to be in the freshman homeroom, I'm like, man, I ain't doing this. It's embarrassing to me. You know, I just said, forget the school. got involved.
So when you saying when you went back, like you flunked out and you went back to the do the ninth grade over, do the freshman year over, and you went in the homeroom, you was like, man, I'm out of here. Yeah, this is embarrassing. I'm gonna have to repeat it. Yeah, okay, I see what you're saying. Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, I was a popular dude in the school, you know. But I was involved in ganking, stealing stuff
out on the street. Hey, you said a word, and crazy you said that word, because a couple of days ago, I remember the first time that I heard somebody use this word, and they was actually stealing when I was a little kid, and I walked into the dollar store, and it was an older guy from my neighborhood, one of the big homies I knew from the neighborhood. He was in there stealing. He's like, gank him. So when you said that word, ganking, I just said, I know what area you grew up in.
Yeah, that's me, dog. But I would be selling tapes to the homies out there slanging and stuff. Like, I was a dude that was getting their music. But then I moved from the east side to the west side, and that kind of like shifted, because the west side of Aurora was more of a middle class, upper class financial regiment. So the school district was different than the east side. You know, they had busing. It was just a whole different environment. So I started ganking with them cats. You know, we got a little group. I was like the crazy ass criminal. The group was called Crazy Ass Criminals, you know, CAC. And I had, you know, the curl, khaki, straight out of Compton. You know, it's four of us. And then I got popped off on a dope case. And when I got popped off on the very first dope case, it was like a 16, something real small. And the cops seen me, you know, stash it. And then I sat in jail for three, four days for $1,000 bail. Okay. And I'm like, you know, I wasn't good for a stack. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, we out here getting money. And then from getting out of there, that first little drug case, I'm like, bro, I ain't never going to sit in on no bond case again. I'm never going to do that. Wait, let me back up, because I skipped going to the penitentiary. So when I moved to the west side, I snatched this gold chain. And then I wind up getting arrested, and I would have got a probation. But one of the other homies snatched a gold chain off the lieutenant of the police department's wife.
Oh,
they put that on me, but I didn't do that. And so I wind up getting 3 years in the Department of Corrections.
Okay.
I did like 14 months, 14 months, 9 in the county, and like 4 months in the Department of Corrections. So it wasn't like no hard time. This is back in 91. So,
right.
You know, 90, 91, it was a different, at least in Illinois. I don't know about other states, but this prison wasn't, you know, it was a minimum security.
Right. And your whole time doing that little prison time, what was you doing? Like, you said you did about like 4 or 5 months in the prisons, and then maybe 9+ months in the county, going to
so
prison.
In the county, renegade, you know what I'm saying, getting in all kinds of trouble, going to the hole, you know, a little bit of gang banging. Not major gang banging, because it was, you know, it was all from people from the town. So, you know, we all grew up together. So it wasn't no major stuff. But then once I got to the prison, you know, man, we was in a dorm. So I just came with the guys. And then, like, I was the chief of security. So I had to walk in the back. You know, I went to school, got into it with the guys a couple times, because it's like, we know who you are. Because, you know, they kind of hip to the thing. It's like, you know, we can, you want to keep walking at the back of the line, you know, you're going to be here for a while. Like, basically, we know you short. So I went to talk to the, you know, who had it for the deck over there. And he was like, well, we're just going to take you off. You know what I'm saying? Because it wasn't about like, hey, this is what we're going to do. This. It was like, we'll take you off. And so when I got out, I paroled to my home neighborhood, the house I grew up in. And my dad had been there, moved out, but he was renting it out. And it was a dope house. You know what I'm saying? So I paroled to the dope house, and my homies come over there. He's selling cocaine now. He like, bro, this is a good spot. Right. 3 months later, I get raided.
So your first prison experience, you get out, you go right back to the dope house. You go right to the dope house. And within 3 months, you it's raided.
Yeah. So then I go back to the county. And it was a brother that had been down like 30 years that was back home. He was a stone. good dude. And he basically told me if, because what I did is I confessed to the dope, because one of my homies was in the crib with me. He wasn't slanging. I was going to trade some dope for some pistols. You don't do that by yourself. That just, you know what I'm saying? We don't move like that. And so he ain't had nothing to do with the selling the dope. So I confessed to it. They wind up letting him out. And his brother was an old stone. He was like, if you never would have confessed, you could have beat the case, because he was into the law.
Mm.
So I got a law library pass, and I beat the case in a bench trial.
Oh, man.
I beat the case in a bench trial with a public defender. I got the statement suppressed. And so once I got out from there, it's like 92, December, 93, first 3 months of that year, I stayed in the Kane County Law Library reading all about, you know, drug laws, all that.
Because I was just about to ask you, did when you beat that case, was it because you put the work in, or did you actually have a good public defender? Because most public defenders ain't about to do nothing.
So I had a good public defender, but we bumped heads a lot because, okay, you know, when I read something, I take it for what the word is. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm reading the word the same way cats talk about the scriptures. That's the word. That's the same way the law is. So when I saw what the law was saying, it was the case People versus Nettles and People versus Wolski. And it said mere proximity is insufficient to prove possession.
Okay.
And so what the judge said, I know the dude guilty because I threw his statement out, but the state didn't prove it. And so, you know, boom, man, I popped up out of there. But like I said, the public defender was a good dude. He a good dude though, but he's solid on when he think you out of order, he'll withdraw from your case. He got his own practice now. That's how I know this about him, because we stayed in touch, you know?
Okay.
But once I got out, you know, I got into the game heavy, because now once I knew the laws, I saw it. Wind up having a shorty and then another shorty. And about 96, it was like a whole bunch of murders going. No, so after I had my first daughter, the blueprint came out with growth and development. That's really what happened. And that blueprint, like, shocked my conscience. Like, you know, I'm reading this stuff, and I'm like, whoa, bro. You know, I got to backtrack, because, you know, I had a position in the organization in the town, and I'm like, this ain't what the vision talking about for me. And it's like I had this, what I call on the road to Damascus experience. The light popped on, and I'm like, what the hell? But I still was selling dope. And I had a couple cases, but I was going to beat them because, you know, I had knew the law. And what happened, I went to court one day, and I basically told the judge, if anybody's familiar with that Michelle Alexander Jim Crow book, The New Jim Crow, I told the judge that's what they was doing. You running up that plant, you sitting up there like you're the master of the plantation. You know, I just spit into him. The whole courtroom went quiet. One of my lawyers' face turned red because, in fact, the dude that was a public defender, he was my hired lawyer. He was one of the lawyers. I had a hired lawyer, and I had the old public defender, which he was transferring his practice. It was Bruce Steinberg and a dude named David Kamek. And it just embarrassed the hell out of them. Well, one of them, for real. So they put me in the mental health center for 6 months and said I was unfit to stand trial. And the way they got me is I was 10 minutes late to court. And I'm like, how can I be, you know, a failure to appear? So that's just, you know, another story about that. But when I got out from that 6 months, I had been done left the dope game pretty much alone. But I got into it for a little second, but not to be moving big weight no more. And then I only got one baby mother. Her brother, you know, he had been in the juvie a lot, but he started teaching me about the blueprint, what it meant, teaching me the lid, you know, from a straight walk with a brother standpoint. Then in 96, he got murdered along with like 27 other people in the town. It was like 28 murders that year. And so I left the town, moved to Naperville, which is an affluent suburb, started selling cars.
And how important was that move? Was it a must that you made that move?
It was, because my brother, he got shot in front of the crib. And then two days later, or a day after, they came back and I had a shootout through the window. But my baby's mom, you know, she was pregnant at that time. Mm. And so she was like, boom, I'm up. I'm going to Atlanta. Because it was her brother that got killed.
Right.
You know, and we were staying there. It was our crib. So then she like, I'm moving to Atlanta. And I'm like, nah, don't go. You know what I'm saying? I'll get us up out of here. But she was already up, you know. So right. she left. And she was pregnant with my second daughter. She went to Atlanta. And I moved to Naperville. But it was a secured building, you know, where we had a guard 24-7. Like, you couldn't even get in the building, you know, because it was a 24-7 guard there.
Right.
So I was like, I got it secure. She eventually did come back. But then I started selling cars at this car dealership. And then I wound up going to church, getting ordained as a deacon. And then, so it's like 2000, 2001. That's when I straight started the journey of just getting life together. Wind up, I had my third daughter in 99. I got married in 98 and got involved in the community. And the police officer that raided me wind up being the chief of police. And we sat on a board together. Like, you know, we would go to breakfast, like super solid dude. He would, with me, him, the mayor, the state rep, will be at the table with certain brothers in the community from street tribes, you know, discussing violence that was going on. And then I just, boom, 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 started transgressing there. Got involved with the Kauai County Urban League, just different organizations. And then I wind up opening up a mortgage company.
Oh, yeah. You say you wind up opening up a mortgage company? How did you get involved in
so it was a
into
dude
the mortgage company? Like, yeah, how did you end up getting off into that?
It's a dude that I was selling cars with. And one day I bumped into him downtown in Aurora. He was old Slickster dude. But he was doing mortgages back then.
Okay.
And he was telling me, man, you be good at this, woo, woo. You can make 5-6 racks. And so I'm like, really? Boom. I went and got me suited up and just sat in there and learned the game, you know? And so he fired me because he was a Slickster dude. Because, you know, when you cut from the streets, you know what I'm saying? Can't nobody just pull one on you.
Right. Right.
And so he was trying to run that slick stuff, you know, and I got one of the homies across the parking lot with 30-06, like, dude, don't give you this paper, you know, we finna boom. And you know what I mean? Because I still had that mindset, you know
that
what I'm
mindset,
saying?
Right.
But we, you know, my pops came through, we wind up, you know, squashing it, letting it, you know, go like whatever. And then I started my own mortgage company because they had heard about this company guy was working with. So then I went to go connect with some Jews, and then I just did the paperwork, fam, and just did what I needed to do, work with them for 3 years, and then I started my own business. I got the mortgage license, got the surety bond, everything that it was required, you know. Okay. I started getting properties, just really a whole turnaround.
And was it, and when you started your mortgage company, did you have any problems with your background and when it came to investing with the properties and stuff like that?
Not at all, bro. This was like 2000. So it was a different, you know what I'm saying, environment. We still evolving as people. And so it wasn't about this whole big mass criminal justice reform. That wasn't even an issue back then, you know?
Right.
At least if it was, it didn't affect me. And so from there, I wound up getting caught up in the foreclosure crisis. Mm-hmm. They put a foreclosure on my house, and then I spent 13 years learning about mortgage servicing fraud, securitization. I mean, I did so much, learned it, went to the NAACP, became a vice president, chairman of housing. So I'm still evolving in this journey, you know, just going with it. Wind up going across the states with the NAACP, and I wind up suing several of the banks in federal court for under RICO for running the criminal enterprise.
You hit the banks with the RICO?
Man, bro, that's what they is. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Man, that's so when you because I need you to break this one down to me. When you say that's what they is, break it down, you know, in a way to what you mean by that.
So a criminal enterprise is some which if cats here know, you have let's say the Bank of New York. That is the major company. So under the Bank of New York, they have a servicer. And the servicer is connected through this thing called a pooling services agreement, where they pool all these mortgages together, okay? So in order to skim the money from the people, the servicer would hold the payment. So if you pay your payment on the 13th, they won't post it until the 16th. So then now you get a late penalty. And so once you get the late penalty, when you go to make the next month's payment, they take the late penalty. You know what I'm saying? So then your payment is never
from the next. Yeah, so you ain't never made no full payment.
And that's a scheme.
Yeah, that's a stone cold scheme.
And they were doing that with insurance on properties. They say, oh, you don't got insurance on your property, but you do because you had to get it, you know, when you close. And then they'll force place insurance, raise your payment. So then you can't never make the payment. So it was just a way for them to extract money. And, bro, I could get into that so deep because I love it. But they was double dipping, too. They had insurance on the mortgages, but then they'll come into court and try to sue you for the scheme that they was doing. And I uncovered it. And so I hit them running a criminal enterprise. I named all the players. I said the attorneys was aiding and abetting them. And just, you know what I'm saying?
Right. I sued them. Because that's how the government going to hit. That's how the government will hit you.
Most definitely. Most definitely. So I started, you know, from a spiritual aspect, which I didn't know at that time, I began to flip the script. You know what I'm saying? Like, now I'm on the righteous side, at least dealing in that type of life. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to hold y'all accountable.
Right.
And so from that point, that foreclosure, kind of like, you know, and our marriages young, no positive marriages to model, no mentoring, you know, we didn't know how to, you know, navigate through the difficulty, but I wasn't, going to be able to navigate through the difficulties anyway. Cause I wasn't faithful. I was an adulterer. So I still wouldn't been able to see the righteous path because I still was blind by my actions, what I was doing. So right. It wind up disrupting the family. And I say that because I cannot just blame that foreclosure situation on my the growth of the marriage, because I still was coming in with what I call unclean hands. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I can't be like, well, this happened. It attributed to it. And I wind up suing them. Like I said, going for 13 years, started helping over 200 people in the community. You know, traveled around the states with that too. So from there, got a divorce, went to school, got a bachelor's degree in paralegal studies. But I had to get that because I was trying to figure out how to sue these banks and stuff, you know,
right,
what to do. So I just, you know, was trying to learn. And then I wind up, one of the professors, he had a law firm in this city. And he called one day, like, look, I'm looking for some paralegals. Man, I'm like, cool, you know, I'm gonna go check dude out. And I wound up working with him for 3 years. That's where I met my wife. My wife now, my queen. And then once I was able to uproot all those years because I had never been faithful longer than 6 months, period. You know, for 20-some years, I was, you know, mentally, I would say I was trapped. But then some things came out with our relationship that just made me have to face that enemy, that one that was inside of me. And once I was able to defeat that enemy, realizing I didn't have to be afraid to be committed, you know, my mother wasn't going to leave me no more, my girl ain't going to leave me, like all of these things that kept me trapped, we was able to get married. And then I was just able to see things different, hear more clear, you know, through the spirit realm. And one day, May 3rd, 2019, the father, you know, that's what I call my creator, the father cut into me and said, son, will you want to consider running for president? I'm like, yeah. And so that's how I, you know, joined into the campaign to run for president. No experience, but I do what I always do. Grab them books, read, ask questions, call the FEC. Then I wind up joining the Libertarian Party, did some debates with them, which really I was just getting trained in some more stuff, you know, how to operate and just gain my voice, you know what I'm saying? Gain, you know, my clarity and my platform. So I didn't make the presidential choice to pick, because I didn't even show up to the debate, whatever they were doing, because the spirit was like, man, ain't got time for that. And then I ended the campaign with me being an independent, and I wind up being the hood candidate because I had the suit on with the hood, but I also was a human right candidate too. So it just wasn't trying to say it was just this platform. And I had a really solid platform. So then after, you know, I got like 17 votes that I could verify, you know, I was a write-in candidate, you know, went to California, Iowa a few times, went to South Carolina. So I was making some moves. But then after that, I wind up saying, you know what, I'm going to keep my platform going. And so that's what I'm doing right now. I'm living out my platform in the sense that I have a lawsuit against the United States right now and 32 other states that declare that that 13th Amendment legalized slavery and that must be abolished. So I sued them. You know what I'm saying? I sued my local police department. I called them slave patrol, slave catchers. That's why you only target certain neighborhoods. Because this is the root, this is the seed which y'all have grown from. And just calling them out, you know, I got, so coming April, fam, I'm gonna start hitting up these cities with the RICO Act. I'm gonna start suing the police departments in the cities, you know, the states for running the criminal enterprise, racketeering is the slavery of the people. Cause slavery is a racketeering. That's a predicate act. It's a racketeering when the racket is slavery. So even though you're saying it's only costing $23,000, this is an $85 billion industry. If we go back to 1860, it was a $4 billion industry. So it didn't do nothing but evolve. It's just slavery by another name. And so we're very conscious on that.
Right. And you know, I made a video a while back talking to basically the same thing you're just saying, how slavery never ended. It just evolved. That what you said, exactly what I said. I mean, that's just how it happened. You know, and the 13th Amendment really does need to be abolished, just the way it is worded. The practices in prisons, I've been in prison several times where I had prison jobs, that if them jobs was getting paid on the streets, they probably would be making 50, 60,000 a year. And here I am making 53 cents an hour, if that, right. $22 a month at the most. Doing these jobs, and one of the best jobs I had in prison was probably $100,000-$200,000 a year job, and that was working at the governor's mansion, doing being a lead pantry worker when I was on work release in the state prison. On my way home, I got a job at a work release doing working at the governor's mansion, doing the lead pantry. I'm talking about when they had big banquets and big dinners. We got to set the tables. We got to put the order in for all the glasses and stuff we need. Carried the little trays. We was out there looking like Eddie Murphy and them on Coming to America. Yeah, they were like, we was out there working for the McDowells, you know. But that's all included. That's all the result of the 13th Amendment. Correct. And people don't really understand how important it is, because it don't say if you were sent to prison, you become a slave. It says if you were duly convicted of a crime. And my position on that is, if they really want to say those that ain't been to prison but being convicted of a crime fall up under that too. So if they really want to really push that, then that you will fall in there. You don't have to be in prison or went to prison just to suffer from that law, that amendment.
I appreciate you saying that, because all the citizens are slaves. And I'm going to tell you why. When you look at that 13th Amendment, which I just want to end the exception clause in there, but involuntary servitude is in that 13th Amendment. So if you go to work and the government is taking money out of your check, that is involuntary servitude. Because we don't work for the government. Man created the government. Government didn't create man. So why are you taking from man? Because you think we're slaves, and I can get into all that because it's got something to do with the birth certificate. That's a whole nother thing.
I know what you're saying. Yeah.
This whole system is designed to stop us from living in our freedom element, to stop us living in our natural created element that was created from a creator, whether that be nature or God's nature, because that's the unalienable rights that we were given to. So when you get this mindset of having the freedom, you can't let nobody oversee you because you're a creator, and creators create. That's why I ran for president, because I could not see nobody that could represent our interests. Nobody could talk about the hood. You couldn't talk about criminal justice reform because you can't reform it. It needs to be abolished. You can't talk about reforming the police because it needs to be abolished. What we need to do is put in correctional institutions, but the correctional institutions shouldn't have 2 million people in there. So we got to figure out, where did the 2 million people come from? From the Reagan era, from the Nixon era. Well, why did that happen in the Nixon era? Because they had a war on drugs. Well, what happened before that? The COINTELPRO. We still got brothers in prison right now from the 60s. But we know the COINTELPRO was a discriminatory movement. So why them people ain't coming home? Because our generation ain't stood up to bring them home. That's why. You can't run around here talking about Marcus Garvey, never ask somebody to do for you what you ought to do for yourself, and you steady asking somebody to represent you, because you're not representing the principles of Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, Mandela, or any one of those other ancestors that laid it down. We just cannot wait no more. So what I'm saying is, now across the states, they done got wind to the hood candidate, because I'm pushing that pen on these cats, helping cats with habeas, you know, doing all the stuff I got to do. And now they see us a brother out here that ain't looking to be the president. I'm looking to be the servant. See, right. It's a difference. See, the greatest among you going to be your servant, not your president, you know, because before it was president, it was chief. Where would you get the word chief from other than the tribes? Meaning that we got to get back to our roots, because it's a spiritual thing. And we looking in the natural trying to figure out who the hell we are. Well, our identity been stolen. So if you're looking at them to figure out who you are, you're going to be messed up. You got to look within. And when that spirit arises, that sleeping giant, then you realize it only take 300 of us to run for office, and we got a super majority. We can do what we want to do then, but we don't got to wait till we get elected. Because I'd be damned if I say, when I get elected, this is what I'm going to do. We doing it now. Because there's brothers that may not make it home waiting on somebody to get elected. Right. Man, please.
Exactly. So I wanted to ask, go ahead.
Say what?
So I wanted to ask, when you started the hood candidate, when you started getting involved in the politics and in this run, and you going to these different states, what would you say is the biggest thing that you picked up and learned during that process? And this process is still going on as well.
I believe that people, they know something is wrong, they just don't know how to fix it, you know? And because it really started with me. I had to believe that I could actually represent what I was saying, because I didn't have a spiel. I didn't have no script, you know what I'm saying? I said, I am the script, you know what I'm saying? What can I bring you other than authenticity? You know, I learned about really what the roles is of government, which is to serve the people. And each one of these elected officials have a job description. I learned that I can't say I'm running for president, I'm gonna do all this for you. I learned the only thing I could tell you is I can assist you with the tools and resources to empower you to do it for yourself. Because a man can't change another man. That's where oppression comes in. You have to want to be free, but if you cannot see, again, that's what the whole thing is. If you cannot see, even though we're not blind like Ray Charles, we still can't see, because we can only see what we've been taught to believe.
Right.
So
I agree.
I realized that I can only speak truth. And I got to say, I don't want to say power to the people. The people have the power. It ain't no power to the people. You can't give me something I already have.
I have, right.
So we have to be, you know what I'm saying, be real with it. And then another thing I say I learned is, to me, it's not about the black-white thing. It's about classism.
You understand what I'm saying? I'm glad you said that.
It's about our nationality.
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
It's not about race. It's not. The race is who gonna win. That's what the race is. And you think about this, when people run for office, imagine if everybody ran in the marathon. Your mama ain't no good. You did this. What kind of race would that be? So when you running for an office and you got to talk down about your opponent, you shouldn't be the one. We shouldn't be looking to that.
Right.
Because if we agree with those people, then what we saying, that's something in them that we can relate to in us.
And we agree in their tactics.
Oh, what happened? And muted?
I said, no. Yeah, you hear. You still hear. I said, and then what they're saying is.
Oh, I can't hear you no more, Big Kardell.
Can you? What about now? Can you hear me now?
I lost you on the voice train. Can you still hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
I cannot hear you. What about now?
Can you hear me?
I can't hear you, Kardell.
Okay, so how about, let's see, try leaving the room and coming back.
Is something I did on my end?
Let me see. Can y'all everyone hear me out there?
Audio.
If you tuned in, can you hear me?
Automatically, so. Bro, I don't know what to do, Kardell.
We're gonna see if he can log back in and try something else. Yeah, leave the room and come back in. There you go. I appreciate it. I appreciate you tuning in with us too, Gabriel Cord, Chief Information Officer. We really appreciate you. We've had a good, great conversation. So hopefully the brother will be able to enter back in the studio and he'll be able to hear me. I know he had froze up there for a minute and then he came back. There you go. Let's see what we got.
I got you.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
All right. So yeah, we back in. So we was talking about things that do what you learned, and you was talking about how it's not power to the people. The people had the power.
Correct.
And so in this process of understanding that we have the power, and we seeing a lot of people that's coming in and somewhat representing, we see more and more activists and hood candidates that are starting to get in the realm. And when you was talking about that, it made me think of what we see going on in Louisiana with the brother Gary Chambers. What's your thoughts about that brother? Because, you know, he caught a lot of backlash, you know, with his commercial for smoking. But I've been watching this brother do a lot of political activist work in this field, in this community for the past 4 years, going in meetings, calling a lot of politicians out. So what do you think about him? How do you feel about what he got going on?
I love him 100%. And I think I try to reach out to him on Instagram. But I really appreciate any individual that rocks with their inalienable rights. Because what he's doing is showing the people not to be afraid.
Mm.
So when these individuals are on TV and trying to mock him and say, woo, woo, da, woo, ba, da, bam, I guarantee you, and I'm not judging them because I realize we all have some indoctrination in our mindset that's got us brainwashed on all sides. But anytime an individual is walking in his freedom and liberty, that threatens the establishment because they've been mentally trained to think we are slaves, to think that we are less than them.
Mm.
But we have been taught that too, though. So I can't just say one group of people, because what he is showing is, I am somebody.
Right.
He don't get distracted by what other people think or say. He keeping it moving. And so I applaud him in that, you know. I love that. So.
Right. Yeah, that's what's up. So, somebody getting out of prison. Somebody getting out of prison. They might be getting out of prison right now. They might get out tomorrow or next week. And they got this idea that they want to get off into the political field, but they think their criminal background or their background is going to hold them back. What advice would you give them? They would see this next week, and they come over here and see. What advice would you give to them?
Go to www.hoodcandidate.com. Just look for the hood candidate. Get up with me. And this is what I would tell them. How to do it. If the state that they're going into says convicted felons can't run for office, sue them. And when you sue them, you tell them this is a badge, an incident of slavery, because this is what you did to my ancestors and you trying to do it to the descendants. If you don't want me to run for office, don't think about taxing me, because you ain't finna get no taxation without representation. Because that's the same thing that happened when the English tried to move from them Brits. When them Europeans came over here, escaping them British rule, it was taxation without representation. And that's the same thing we doing now, but since we don't understand or know history or don't know what to do. So remember, when I say we don't know what to do, that means we just don't know what to do. I show you a library over here because I stay reading, researching, learning. But when you finish learning, it's time to implement. We can't keep reading all damn day now, brother.
Right, yeah.
You don't have to write.
You got to start applying what you read. You got to start utilizing what you read.
And so anybody coming home wanting to get in politics, you know, we have a political party called the Democratic Republican Party. But that was a party that already existed. All I did was resurrect it. And what I feel in my heart, there's nothing new. Everything we're doing has already been done. The only thing new is we've seen it for the first time.
Oh, you froze up. Can you hear me? You froze up on us. Can you hear me?
You know what? It did it again. Every time my phone rang, that's what happened.
Yeah, that's what I think.
You should have logged back out and pop back in for a second. Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, and that's a good point. And those of you that haven't tuned in and don't know, we say Gary Chambers as being a representative and more of a hood candidate politician as well. Check him out and check out the brother Andy Williams, because the moves that he's making is real powerful. And I live in one of them states that says that you can't hold a public office. All right.
I'm finna block these calls from coming in. Give me one second. Right. And that way I ain't got to worry about nobody trying to call. And you know who are calling me? One of the brothers from the penitentiary.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, we ain't got nothing but a couple more questions, man, so you can get back with the brothers. But I'm saying that because I know of several people that had got out of prison. And, like, I live in a state where I live in one of them states that says you can't hold public office.
Missouri.
In Kansas, you can, which is the state right next over. Because when they gave me when I got the federal prison, then I had to walk down federal probation. And when they gave me my final discharge paper, it said, now you're able to get your voting rights and you're able to run for public office in Kansas, but not in Missouri. So Missouri is one of them states as well. I got a question that I ask all my guests. And this question is really based around what the podcast is about. And it is, if you had one word to describe this journey that you're on, that you've been going through, what would that one word be and why? Why that one word?
It would be liberated.
And why liberated?
Because the journey has helped me liberate myself.
Mm.
It's all about self and not selfishly. Because you can't give what you don't have. If you don't know how to love you, how you gonna love somebody else? If you can't serve yourself, how you gonna serve somebody else? We gotta stop giving away what we see everybody else doing. And we got to take time to give to our own self. I mean, just look here, bro. I've been in the bed watching TV all day. This is what I was doing. Because that's just what I felt like doing.
Right. Right. But yeah, I most definitely feel you on that. Self has to come first. Because you can't serve, you can't do for anything, anyone else or any other organization or whatever, if you can't do for self, if you don't have self together. I used to argue with people because one of my things was valuing myself first above anything. People said, well, no, you need to put a high power and stuff first. And I'm like, if I don't value myself, I can care less about a high power. Once I start learning to value me, then I start getting the understanding of value and a higher power and things like that. Then as I get that understanding, if it happens to switch, then yeah. But most important, if I don't value me, because I've been in a state where I didn't value me, value my freedom. So everything else outside of that didn't value.
Right. And I'm with you with that. But it's all about liberation. This journey is all about liberation. You know, learning to know myself. It's the best thing. And you know, when you say a higher power, the higher power to me is here. It's the mental, it's the conscious. Because the higher power that we think is outside, if we read and understand the scriptures, it says, greater is he that is. Did I lose you, big dog?
No, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. It's in me. The power is in us. It's not outside. And that's why people have been so far behind, because they don't understand the spirituality of the ancestors and their movement resurrects in us.
Mm-hmm.
Once we die to self, because again, we're not doing nothing new. Everything has already been done. You know, we had freedom suits back in the 1870s. Them sisters and brothers in Virginia, Massachusetts, all them, they filed freedom suits to get their freedom. And that's what we're doing now. So I write to the brothers in these institutions, these plantations, I send them the instructions. Hey, this is what you got to do. This is what you got to fill out. Had a whole movement in Alabama. I sent about 20-something letters. Only three of them brothers responded back. Four. In each state, I'm picking cats off one by one. You know, because I see we can do it. And the last thing I'm going to say with this, unless you got a question, in April, I'm going to come at that 1994 crime bill. And in the 1994 crime bill, there's a lot of unconstitutional elements in there. So when I attack those, that's what's going to set people free. Because even though I'm attacking the 1994 crime bill, I'm really starting back in 1921 with Henry Anslinger, who was a protege of J. Edgar Hoover, that knew that the classification on drugs was really based on racial anatomy. It had to do with your ethnicity. If you was the Hispanic, or if you know was a person of color, that marketing propaganda was geared towards that, to say, oh, these drugs gonna make you crazy and all that. No, it all had to do with racial. It had to do with your skin color. It really, that back then literally did. So I just, if we attack it like that, we have to get to the root of it. Too many times we just trying to attack something at the surface. And the reason why I started doing one by one is so I could understand the steps and the procedures. You know, if this brother don't make it, great, I learned from him, but I'll be back. Like, you know, Johnny Crockett with Geronimo Pratt. I'll be back. I'm coming to get you, baby.
Right.
So that's it. You know, we coming for the liberation for all the people, you know, all the people. And really attacking the mental health, you know what I'm saying? Which is really not mental health. It should be trauma healing. That's what we need to be doing. Because we've all experienced some type of trauma that manifests in our day-to-day lives today.
Right. Yeah, but I most definitely agree.
Yeah. So we're going to get that state of Missouri straight. Just give me one cat that ain't afraid to go up against that system and is willing to go up in that courtroom if need to be. I get that paperwork out there to Missouri by April, and them jokers will get that you can't vote public office law abolished.
Bad. Guaranteed. Yeah, we're gonna have to connect on that. Also, speaking of that, if anybody else wants to connect with you and they watch this, how can they get in touch with you? What do they need to do?
www.hoodcandidate.com, Facebook Hood Candidate, the Instagram is Hood Candidate or the Ex-Offender. But the Hood Candidate's that brand. Hood Candidate and the Ex-Offender. You can get me, you know, on Instagram like that. Or if you're on LinkedIn, because you know that's how stuff get done, LinkedIn. Just
go LinkedIn.
Andy Williams Jr. LinkedIn, one of the best things they got out there right now, bro.
Yeah, it is. It is. So we appreciate you, man. I appreciate you coming on, sharing your story. I appreciate the work that you're doing and the example that you set, because I know a lot of brothers that got backgrounds that get out of prison or the business of trouble, and they really want to get in the political field because they doing a lot of activism stuff inside the neighborhoods. They're going up against the elite. They putting new sheriffs in. They putting new judges and stuff in, but they really want to be put in a position themselves, but they fear because of their background. So, you know, this is really important. What you're doing is really important, and you're showing the way. And you actually showing the way for me, because that was one thing that I really want to attack towards the end of this year, once I get everything else lined up, was attacking the thing of not being able to hold public office, because it's been a thought that I had as well. So what you're doing is important. I'm watching. A lot of us is watching, man. Keep being the representation for us. Keep pushing it forward. Keep bringing that knowledge. Keep getting that knowledge. And not only you getting it, you're bringing it out and you're putting it to work. You're manifesting your vision, man. You're being the boss of your mission. You represent your higher self. And I really salute you on that. I really appreciate you and everything that you do. Thanks for being a guest. And do you have any final words?
I thank you, brother. And one thing that I do and I would love to do with you is let's put together a teaching thing. You know, like I can show you right now, hey, this is what we got to do, give you the blueprint. But then if we take that blueprint and do it as a movement, you know, so we done talk to people about their inalienable rights, how to enforce their rights. Because you don't fight for your rights. That's something you was given to by birth. You represent your rights. So we have to teach the people about their rights. The Constitution is not your rights. Your rights is given to you by the God of nature, the creator. That's where your rights come from, based on the Declaration of Independence. So you declare your rights. The Constitution is just there to enforce them. So we just teach the people. The greatest title I ever could have would be a teacher. Well, a servant. But a servant is a teacher, because you're willing to show the people. I don't want people to go through what I go through or went through. No, I went through it so you don't have to. But you still have to learn, though. You know what I'm saying?
And, right.
You know, that's its own platform on its own, you know? Because you know we was hard-headed, you know? Cass was trying to tell us.
Yeah. Cass was trying to tell us, you know, we got to learn on our own. We're gonna learn our way. But, man, thank you. Thank you for everything. Again, thank you for being a guest. Thank you for coming on. Feel free to join our reentry support group if you're on Facebook. We got a reentry support group. You can be and interact with a lot of people that's been on this podcast, a lot of people that's wanting to be on the podcast, a lot of individuals that's getting out and they want to do some things. So I think you'd be a great asset to the group with your information and everything that you know. And, man, keep on doing what you're doing. Sure. We're proud of you. And we're glad to have you as an asset to the reentry community.
Right on. We're glad to have you too, brother, because I couldn't be doing what I'm doing without you. You know?
Thanks a lot.
It's a mutual, you know, we colleagues and I just say, you know, my strength is in this, but any strength that you have, that I have, could teach each other. And that's the unity that we are building now. We're building that. We're coming back together. You know, I don't want to ever say the conversation, oh, well, that he doing this and I want you to see this. Nah, bro, I see what you doing. So now we colleagues, and you need to be on a podcast. Hit my brother here, you know, not come to my podcast. I don't have one yet. You know what I'm saying? So we just going to all keep networking and building. And like I said, with that, we only need a team of 300 people across the states, man. That's all we need. 300 solid, committed individuals that we know we can count on, depend on, pick up that phone and call, and they word is bond, and we will change this nation. Guaranteed.
And there you have it, right there, 300, and we could change the nation. This is another episode of the Reentry Journey. We'd like to thank our guest, Mr. Andy Williams, for coming in, man, giving us that them hood politics, being a hood candidate. And once again, you know, we're here to support you on your journey. Thanks for being a guest, and we wish you nothing but success amongst your journey.
Thank you, my brother.
All right, pleasure having you on.
All right, peace out.
All right,
peace out.
And we go with another episode of the Reentry Journey. Great episode. Make sure that you all, if you are any interest of getting involved in, you know, whole public office, and you feel like that your records and your background are going to be a problem, get with the brother, Mr. Andy Williams, the hood candidate, and get with him. I guarantee you he's going to get you right. He's going to put you on the right track. Thanks for tuning in to the Reentry Journey. I am the host, Kardell Sims. I will be signing off. And until next time, be safe. If you have any problems, need any support, hit us all up. We're here for one another. Nothing about us, without us. This is the Reentry Journey.